There is a Roman maximum in law that says, for he that would be deceived, let him. Simply meaning, if you are so ignorant as to be deceived, then that's your business, that's your problem. So you need to do your homework and find out what the words mean, especially in relation to law and government. Because there is a world of occultism that is operating today in which you use certain words, and when those words are used in a court, they don't mean the same thing at all. Understanding law and the words of law, there are two things that this planet has: water and earth, water and land. Consequently, there are two kinds of law: the law of the land and the law of water. You need to understand the difference. The law of the land is the law of the culture that lives on the land. And so consequently, the law of the land is different in every country. You can do things in America you can't do in Russia. However, there is a higher law that dominates the entire world. It's called the law of the water. The law of water is referred to as the law of money. It doesn't matter what color you are, where you're from, or where you live. Money is money. And any time you're doing banking or using money, you are now under the law of water, maritime admiralty. If you go back in history where all of this began, back in the land of Cana, and you probably have heard in the Bible the land of Cana. The Canaanites were Phoenician bloodline. And in the ancient Phoenician language, Cana meant merchant banker. The very word merchant comes from mer, M-E-R, for the sea, for water. As a mermaid, we have merchant. Merchant bankers. Let me give an example of the difference between the law of water and the law of the land. The Statue of Liberty must be put in water. It could not be put on American land as such. It had to be put in the harbor because it's not the Statue of Freedom. It's a Statue of Liberty. Liberty is what a sailor gets when he pulls into port on a ship. He gets liberty. He's not free. So America is not the land of the free and the home of the brave. We're not free or brave, period. And make no mistake, they do not pick words by chance. These words are very serious. Now let me give you an example of how this law of the water works. Why is it that you have to go to court? You go to court because you play basketball and tennis on a court. How do you play tennis on a court? You play with a racket. Why? Because that's what it is. It's a racket. When you go into a court, what's the idea of going to court? It's a game, like basketball. The whole idea in a court, one team gets up and they throw the ball over to that team of lawyers. That team gets up and throws the ball back into their court. And the judge is wearing a black robe, so he is the referee. He doesn't care which side wins or loses because he's going to get paid anyway. So he couldn't care less. The judge is a referee between two teams. The judge rules from the bench. The word bench in Latin is a bank. Therefore, the judge rules for the bank. Where do you find banks? You find banks on both sides of a river. They're called river banks. And what does a river bank do? It directs the flow of the current, see. Consequently, your money is current, see, because it's the flow, the cash flow. I'll give you an example of how this works. When a ship pulls into a harbor, all ships are referred to as female. Why? There's a very good reason. Maritime Admiralty Banking Law says all ships are female because they're carrying items for money, and so consequently they are under Maritime Admiralty Law. Admiralty is where we get the word admiral, admiral of the Navy. Let me give you an example of how this works. When a ship pulls into a harbor, it parks at the dock. The captain has to provide for the port authorities a certificate of manifest because yesterday the ship was not here. But this morning the ship pulled in, so it has manifested. So consequently, all the products have manifested. So each one of those items coming off of that ship has come off of water. And consequently, on a ship, all ships have a captain. The word captain comes from a Latin word, capital, money. So the captain represents the money that's on board the ship. And as I said, the captain has to present to the port authorities a certificate of manifest for each and every item. How much does it weigh? What color is it? How many doors does it have, etc.? The ship is sitting in its berth. Wherever a ship sits when it docks is called its berth, berthing a ship. All the items, as I said, coming off that ship represent money. They came in on water. They are maritime admiralty products. Now, when you were born, your mother's water broke. And when your mother's water broke, you came out. And this is why you have to have a birth certificate, because you are a maritime admiralty product under international law. Your mother delivered you. This is why if you go to Sears and buy a refrigerator, they will ship it to you. They will deliver it. And that's why you were in your delivery room. Your mother was delivering a product. Maritime admiralty. You came down your mother's birth canal. And once you, and as you're taking one of the televisions or the cars off the ship and it falls down and breaks, that's all right. Sometimes they're stillborn, so consequently you've lost money on that one. Therefore, you have to have a death certificate, and it's always signed by the dock. The dock has to sign your birth certificate and your death certificate. All of these words and terms are maritime admiralty banking words. And therefore, if you understand lawyers and judges and courts and government are all under international maritime admiralty law. All religions, all churches in the world operate under maritime law. This is why all churches are divided into denominations, like 20s and 50s and 100s. This is why they're called denominations, because all churches are nothing more than the product of maritime admiralty banking. It's an extraordinary story of occult treason, high treason and crimes against the state. Make no mistake about it. The concept of human, spiritual, intellectual, and physical freedom never, ever existed on the earth. Think about this. When cowboys in Indian movies, when the cowboys would ride into town, they were wearing guns. How come they could walk into a bar carrying guns? And if two guys got in an argument, they could go out on the street and draw on each other in front of the sheriff's office, and the sheriff would do nothing. The reason why is because before 1868, all Americans were considered sovereigns. In 1868, there was a corporation founded. They referred to it as the United States Corporation. And they stipulated that anybody who would be a member of that corporation or work for that corporation would be called not an employee, but a citizen. So today, if you are asked, are you a citizen of the United States, what you think you're being asked is, are you lawfully in this country to do business? They didn't ask you if you were in America lawfully. They ask you a specific question. Are you of your own volition, out of your own mouth, testifying that you are a citizen of the United States? Because in that way, citizen of the United States means you are an employee of a foreign corporation operating on international maritime law. So today, the president of the United States is the president of a privately owned company. The company is called United States. And the word president is always a word that is used in corporate law. Banks have presidents. All companies have presidents. So there's a corporation called United States, privately owned, and it has a president. Privately owned, out of England. And you need to understand words and terms. Because I believe that there is a divine presence in the universe that men call God. And one day that divine presence is going to move on the earth and we're going to see freedom come back to this world. And when it does, you're going to need to understand words and terms and how they have been used to trick you. These words have been used to enslave you.